فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
The other one is متابعة قاصرة. What is متابعة قاصرة? The متابعة قاصرة is this one. Pay attention. Is that Ibn Khuzaima narrated from his chain of narration by from who? Asim ibn Muhammad, who narrated from his father, whose name is Muhammad ibn Zayd, who narrated from his granddad, whose name is Abdullah, and Jaddihi Abdullah ibn Umar, which his granddad is Zayd ibn Abdullah ibn Umar. The wording, فَأَكَمِّلُ الثَّلَاثِينَ. Complete 30. So this is called a mutaba'a qasira. The wording is the same. Is the companion the same? Yes, Abdullah ibn Umar. So we have a mutaba'a tamma and we have a mutaba'a qasira. Now we need a shahid. The shahid for this hadith is what? A shahid is Abdullah ibn Abbas' chain of narration. That Imam al-Nasa'i narrated min riwayat Muhammad ibn Hunaynin. Because Abdullah ibn Abbas is he another companion. Yeah. So this can't be a mutaba'a. This is the shahid. Okay. Now Abdullah ibn Abbas' narration is what? فَإِنْ غُمَّ عَلَيْكُمْ فَأَكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةَ ثَلَاثِينَ. So, now brothers, are you guys all with me?
No.
Us looking at the chain of narrations, saying that this chain is mutaba'a qasira, this is mutaba'a tamma, and this is a shahid, us following the chain of narration, us doing that work right now, where I just gave you the examples, did you guys see it?
Yeah.
That is called i'tibar. Are you guys with me? Analyzing the chains of narrations to know where is the mutaba'a. What type of mutaba'a is it? Mutaba'a tamma, or is it mutaba'a qasira? Or is it what? Is there a shahid for this hadith? This is called what? I'tibar, and Al-Hajar mentions it. وَتَتَبُّعُ الطُّرُوقِ. Following the chain of narration. لِذَلِكَ. To find out what type of mutaba'a it is. Or whether it's shad. وَتَتَبُّعُ الطُّرُوقِ لِذَلِكَ هُوَ الْإِعْتِبَارُ. That's called i'tibar. That is called i'tibar. So for example, now what we will say is, مثلاً, now what we say is, regarding this hadith, بعد الاعتبار. We found out. How would you say it? بعد الاعتبار. After i'tibar, we found out that the hadith of Shafi'i has a what? Has a mutaba'a tamma, mutaba'a qasira, and a shahid. That's what we say. That's what mutaba'a, that's what i'tibar means. ولذلك عراقي says الاعتبار الاعتبار سبر كل حديث هل شارك راو غيره فيما حمل عن شيخه فإن يكن شورك من معتبر به فتابع وإن شورك شيخه فوق فكذا وقد يسمى شاهد ثم إذا متلون بمعناه أتاء فشاهد وما خلا عن كل ذا مفارد. Now, inshallah, in the kitab نخبة الفكر, we're gonna go on to, we finished the topic which is تقسيم الخبر إلى المقبول والمردود. We've taken the مقبول part. Okay? So far we've taken مقبول. We're still in مقبول. مردود, we haven't got to it. The Shaykh is now divided into, before he divided into what? بحيث قوتي وضعفي, صح? In terms of its strength and its weakness. Now we're taking, in this subject, top point, the Shaykh is going to go into تقسيم الخبر المقبول إلى معمول به وغير معمول به. It's خبر which is مقبول, is accepted, but in terms of implementation, in terms of implementation or not implementing it, is what we're going to be talking about, inshallah ta'ala. So ثم المقبول, then the مقبول. So it's four types, inshallah. It's so simple. The four types of dividing into what, that which is accepted and that which is rejected. What is accepted is what? المحكم الناسخ. Okay? They accepted. The ones that are rejected are the opposite, which is مختلف فيه and منسوخ, which is the opposite to the two. So now we're going to take them both, four of them, inshallah. Okay? The ones that are implemented and the ones that are not implemented. Okay? The ones that are implemented and that which are not implemented. The ones that are implemented are called, the first one is called al-muhkam. Okay? Al-muhkam. Muhkam is the Sheikh what he taught. In سلم من المعارضة, it's free from any opposition. Okay, فهو المحكم. So محكم means what? محكم means it's the first of all, it's a لغة linguistically is اسم مفعول, and it means what? It comes from the word أحكم, which means أتقن. Something when it solidifies itself, roots itself. Okay, but technically it means هو الحديث. It is the hadith which is مقبول. سلم من معارضة مثله, and it's safe from any form of opposition to the likes of it. Okay. And that is the type of hadith which we're trying to say, which is muhkam, is it's solid. The opposite you will understand with it. وَإِنْ عُرِضَ بِمِثْلِهِ, if there comes an opposition like it, so it's a hadith which is مقبول, but there's a معارضة, there's an opposition. بِمِثْلِهِ, like it. فَإِنْ أَمْكَنَ الْجَمْعُ, if we're possibly able to bring the chains of narration together, in terms of its meaning, we're able to bring it back there, then we do it. Okay? فَإِنْ أَمْكَنَ الْجَمْعُ, if we're able to bring them together, what is it called? فَمُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثِ. We say this hadith is مُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثِ. Disputed hadith. Now this means a hadith which its meaning is rooted, there's no opposition. This one, there's an opposition. Okay? Are you guys with me? There's an opposition, and we're able to bring them together. Don't worry, examples are going to mention it to you. Such as the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he says, this hadith of Mukhtalaf, disputed upon. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لا عدوة ولا طيرة. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, there is no adu, meaning there is no illness that transmits. There's no transmittable diseases. وَلَا طِيَرَةَ, and there's no superstitions. So that hadith is narrated by Imam Muslim. But then we have another hadith where the Messenger said, فَرِّ, where the Prophet said, فَرَّ, run, مِنَ الْمَجْذُومِ, run from the one who has what? مَجْذُوم. مَجْذُوم is the person who has leprosy. Run away from the one who has leprosy. فِرَارَكَ مِنَ الْأَسَدِ, the way you run away from a lion. Run! And this is Bukhari narrated. But the first hadith is saying what? There's no illness. There's nothing that... Don't run away. There's no type of illness that you need. There's no transmittable disease.
But why would you run away from leprosy?
Because it's a transmittable disease. You can take it from somebody. So what we realize from the hadith, there's mukhtalafun fi. You're thinking, okay, there's an opposition here. What does this mean and what does it mean? Does that make sense? Now this hadith is called mukhtalafun fi. Why is it called mukhtalafun fi? Because we can bring it together. Are we able to bring it together? If it's possible to bring those two chain of narration, what do we say? We say al-mukhtalaf. Are you guys with me?
How can you bring it together?
Okay. Now we're going to bring it together. First of all, the two hadiths are sahih. The outer, ظَاهِرُ مَتْتَعَارُضُ, there's an opposition between the two. Okay? Because the first one, it negates the existence of any transmittable disease. Whereas the second one, it affirms it. So how do we bring the two? The way we bring the two is as follows. We bring it back by saying that the negation of the illness being negated for it to transmit is when in and within itself. The illness does not transmit in and within itself. Are you guys with me? It transmits. The illness cannot do the transmitting. It doesn't choose to transmit or not. It does it with whose permission? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. So when it's negated, it means it's negated that the illness doesn't have the ability to choose. No. I know somebody, I know it, who was married to a woman who lied to him. He married her. Okay. And when he married her, this sister, he was married to her for 17 years. 17 brothers. He had kids with her. He had what?
Kids
with her. They took a medical check. They knew her illness. She didn't tell her husband. She had AIDS. She didn't tell him. She hid it from him. He had children with her. I think 4 or 5 kids with her. They medically found out that none of the kids have AIDS, nor does the husband have AIDS, only she still has AIDS. She has it alone. Allah protected the rest from it. Are you guys with me? At this particular point, did the AIDS, did it transmit?
No.
It does, it's a transmittable disease. But the illness doesn't choose to go to whoever it wants. It does with whose permission? The second hadith is telling you to take the precautions like it. Just because Allah is the one that does it, doesn't mean you throw yourself into every corruption, everything. Now does it make sense?
Yeah.
So the negation and the... So here it's called مُخْتَلَفُ فِيهِ. That's what the Shaykh is saying. ثُمَّ الْمَقْبُولُ. The hadith which is مَقْبُول. إِنْ سَلِمَ مِنَ الْمُعَارَضَةِ. If there's no opposition in terms of its meaning, فَهُوَ الْمُحْكَمْ. This hadith, if the hadith are not going against each other, it's called مُحْكَمْ. If they are going against each other, but we are able to bring them together, but they are going against each other, but we're able to bring them together, وَإِنْ عُرِضَ بِمِثْلِهِ. If there's a مُعَارَضَة, فَإِنْ أَمْكَنَ الْجَمْعُ. If we're able to bring them together, what is it called? فَهُوَ الْمُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثُ. This is called what? مُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثُ. But we're able to bring it together. So pay attention and understand this. If there's no khilaf, it's called what? He said this hadith is muhkam. There's no khilaf. There's no opposition to this hadith. It's muhkam. Are you guys with me?
Yeah.
It's called muhkam. Even in the Quran, what is it called muhkam and? Mutashabih. Hadith is not called muhkam and mutashabih. It's called muhkam and mukhtalafu fi. It's called mukhtalafu al-hadith. It's called mukhtalafu al-hadith. Are you guys with me? What about if we're not able to bring them together? That's what that Sheikh is going to mention to us. If we're unable to bring it together. Oh, la! Ibn Hajj said, if not, وَثَبَتْهَا الْمُتَأَخِرُ. Now, some of you will think, this second option, are you guys with me? I want you to very analyze. This second option, which the Sheikh is going to mention, for us, for two hadiths, from the apparent, to go against each other. They are both authentic. They are both what? Sahih. They're weak and sahih. There's no problem. There's not called al-muhkam and al-mukhtalif al-hadith. There's no need. It's weak. This one didn't exist aslan. We're talking about two hadith which are sahih. We looked at this one. This is saying right. This is saying left. Are you guys with me? Shafi'i mentioned there's 70 ways to bring that hadith together. It's not easy for you to jump to this second resolution. Two hadiths which are 70 wujuh, Shafi'i says in his Kitab al-Risala. So it's not something simple you can just run to. The second option. The second option is once that person tried all of those means to bring the two chains of narrations together in terms of its meanings. He's unable to. And the opposition still stands. At this point, what do? We ask ourselves, is the timing known? The time, is it known? What time are we referring to? We know which narration came first and which one came second. ثبت المتأخر. We know which one is the latecomer and we know which one is the earlycomer. If it becomes clear to us which one came first, huh? We know which one came first and we know which one came last, then we resort to what is known as الناسخ والمنسخ. Are you guys with me? We're going to come to it. فهو الناسخ والمنسخ. Which means what? Abrogated. It's abrogated. The one that came late is the abrogator. And the one that came early is the abrogated. It's abrogated. That's when we've given up those 70 forms of the old Juhul Jama'ah, the ways to bring the narrations together, the ways to... We're unable to. We gave up. Okay? What do we resort to? And we know the timing. We know the what? We know the timing. We say this one's abrogated, this is nasikh, and the next one is called mansukh. What about if we don't know it? We withhold. And we say, Allahu A'lam. If we don't know it, He withhold, and I show you that, and it's rare, and it's close to impossible that that will happen, because somebody else will come and know how to bring it together. Now, nasikh and masukh is a very important knowledge, brothers. Ilmun muhimun. It's a very important topic to learn. What is abrogated, and which one is the science of abrogation? And no one knows it. No one treads on that path except al-fuhul min al-muhaddithin wal-fuqaha. Handpicked, elite scholars of hadith and fiqh. And remember, it is from the necessary things for a person to become a mujtahid. One of the conditions to be a mujtahid is that you know nasikh wal mansukh. You know them. It's very important that the person knows it. How do we learn? What are the ways to know nasikh wal mansukh? One, if it clearly comes from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, clearly. It comes from the Prophet clearly. As he said in the hadith, Imam Muslim narrated, Kuntu, I used to be, the Prophet said this, Kuntu nahaytukum an ziyaratil qubur. I used to prohibit you from visiting the graves. I used to. Fazuruha, visit it now. That's a clear obligation, right? He's saying to you, I used to prohibit you from it, now I order you. So he's telling you, I abrogated my previous speech. That's clear. The Prophet said it. That's called tasrihun an Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second one is, yu'arafu biqawli sahabi. It's known from the companion. It's known from the speech of the companion. Such as the hadith of Jabir ibn Abdullah. Jabir ibn Abdullah. He said, kana akhiru al-amrayni. From the last two of the affairs. So this is sahabi. He said, kana akhiru al-amrayni. From the last two of the affairs was what? Min Rasulillahi, from the messenger of the Prophet, is tarku, is to leave off. Al-wudu, to do ablution. Mimma masat an-nar, that which the water has, that which fire has touched. Back in the beginning, what did they used to do? They used to do wudu from everything. Abrogation came. From the hadith of Jabir, it says that the last of the two affairs was what? That to leave off wudu, anything that goes through fire, you don't have to do wudu from it. Except that which is the camel meat is unique, it's khas, specific. Also, it's known by what? يُعْرَفُ بِالتَّارِيخ. It can also be known by time, the timing. We know which one's which. The year that this one happened, and we know the year of this one. Such as what? مثل حديث الشداد بن أوس مرفوعا. شداد بن أوس, the third type, is يُعْرَفُ بِالتَّارِيخ, is known by timing. Shaddad ibn Awsin, مثلاً, he said that the Prophet said, أفطر الصاحجم, that the fasting of the one who is cupping breaks, and the one that's being cupped, it breaks. That hadith is narrated by who? Abu Dawood and Ibn Majah. The one that takes the blood out of the people, the hajim. The person who does hijama, he's called a hajim. And the one that's done for is called mahjum. The cup, the one that cups, and the one that's cupping, both of them, if their fasting breaks.
If they're not fasting.
Yeah, very, very good. But Ibn Abbas narrated after that, what? Ihtajama al-Nabiyu. The Prophet done hijama. Wahuwa sa'imun. And he was fasting. Shafi'i told us that the second hadith, which is what? The hadith of who? The hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas is abrogated. Sorry, Ibn Shafi'i told us. Shafi'i told us that the second hadith, Ibn Abbas's hadith abrogated the first hadith. Sorry, Shafi'i told us that the hadith of Ibn Abbas abrogated who? The hadith of Shaddad ibn al-Aws. Shaddad ibn al-Aws. He abrogated it. because Shaddad was with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at Fath Sanat al-Thamanin. Because Shaddad was with the Messenger at the time, the 8th year of Hijriah, the conquest of Mecca. Okay? And so he saw a man doing hijama for another man, and then the Prophet said, "Aftar al-hajim wal-mahjum." Are you with me? Whereas Ibn Abbas one was when? Was Sanat al-Hajjat al-Wada', Hajjat al-Wada', which was the last sermon of the Messenger. Which one was last? This one was last 2 years later, because the Hajjat al-Wada' was what year? The 10th of Hijriah. So, and conquest of Mecca was only 8th of Hijriah. How many years later did Ibn Abbas' narration come? So we know by time.